how long it takes me to write something because I'm constantly writing and then I don't know what pieces will become something. But what I do know is that I have a draft, a very long draft of this movie from the end of December of 2013. So at least a couple of years.
So you honed it down. How long is a long draft?
That was about 350 pages. There were a lot more dances. Yeah.
A long draft screenplay or a long draft treatment prose?
Screenplay.
Yeah.
I mean, some of the scenes didn't go anywhere. It wasn't like 350 pages of something that was narratively cohesive. It was 350 pages of stuff that then I kind of looked at and figured out what felt essential and what felt like the core of the story to me. I don't really decide what a core of a story is before I write. I write to figure out what the story is, and I think that the characters end up talking to you and telling you what they want to be doing and what is important to them. And then, so in some ways, your job is to listen as much as to write, and to listen to what these characters that are coming through you are telling you.
Yeah. And at what point did you have Saoirse Ronan in mind at a certain point?
Well, I never had her in mind. I didn't have her in mind while I was writing, but in 2015, I met her actually at the Toronto Film Festival. She read the script and she really responded to it, and I was gonna be there with Maggie's plan and she was gonna be there with Brooklyn. And we met and we sat in her hotel room and she read all of Lady Bird's lines and I read everybody else's lines. And I knew within the first two pages that she was Lady Bird and that she had the part, but then I just selfishly wanted to hear it all out loud except for her. She's such an incredible actress. I really can't say enough about her. There was something about the way she did it. It was instantly different than how I had heard it in my head, and so much better, so much more unique and specific to her. And she has a quality of being always emotionally at a 10, which made it that much funnier, because it was all out of a place of sincerity. She never played the joke with quotes around it. She always played it from the inside, and it made everything vivid in a way that I'd always hoped for, but you just never know that you're gonna find the exact person who's gonna be able to capture that, and she just instantly did it.
It's not working.
Why did you have Lady Bird saying everybody says don't and then making a whistle? That was a big sign.
Oh.
So, this is tailor-made for me.
Yes. I too am a big Sondheim fan, clearly. I've always loved that song, and I thought that it spoke to where her character was at that point of always feeling like everywhere she turned she couldn't move, and also as soon as I heard her sing it, she was just so funny and committed, and she was actually listening a lot to. There's a Barbara Streisand made a recording of that song, and it's a really great recording. And so she was listening to different versions, but she was listening to that version. And then, so in a way, this is her channeling Barbara, which that's enough to make a movie.
Incredible actress and never really has gotten the chance to just like
just, I'm so blessed, and they are so wonderful. And Lori, in particular, I knew I wanted an actor who could hit a home run that felt like exciting, and it felt like a discovery, even though she's, to anyone who's been paying attention, she's not a discovery. But it felt like I knew that she had this enormous power and this enormous skill set and empathy and everything she brings to the character she plays. And I had known her, I'd seen her on stage, I think more than anything else. And I felt like I loved this theater when I saw her, and I thought, I've never in my life seen anything like that unfold in front of me. And so when we were thinking about the part, I had already written the script, as soon as her name came up as a possibility, I thought, yeah, I mean, she's a genius. If she wants to do this. And we talked on the phone, and she was, she's a bit like a great athlete. You have to see it. Like she didn't need to like spend a lot of time going on about the character or anything like that. She just said, I think that this is something I need to do, and sometimes things come into your life at the right moment. And at that moment, she told me, and she said it publicly, so it's not. She said, I have currently a 17-year-old child who's trying to kill me. So I think this is exactly what I need to be doing right now. And she was just, I mean, working with her was extraordinary, and I learned so much from her. And getting to watch her and Saoirse work together, it was like a matchup of two greats, and each one of them had different ways of getting into it. But when they were in scenes together, it was like watching two heavyweights.
And she and Tracy Letts had worked together in theater. No?
Well, actually, interestingly, Lori and Tracy Letts had both. Tracy and Lori both are from the Midwest, and they both, Lori was a founding member of the Steppenwolf Theater Company, and Tracy has worked there as an actor, and also a lot of his plays have premiered there, and he's very much a Chicago actor and writer, but they've never actually acted together. They've known each other for like 30 years, and they've never actually acted together, but I felt like there was something about the intimacy that they had, that they knew each other from before, that it was like, It gave it a kind of reality and a depth that it's hard to achieve on the fly. But they were Midwestern. It felt closer to what I believe Sacramento feels like than something flashy and like LA.
Hey, Greg, you're one of our greatest actresses, and here you're like this astounding writer and a director. What are you going to do next? I mean, which direction, you know, it's fun. Congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you. I,
you're working on a symphony?
I'm moving into opera. I didn't go to film school, proper film school. I went to Barnard College for Women uptown, and I felt like I've worked in film when I started production on this. I'd been working in film for 10 years, and I'd done sort of every job that I could do, and I was lucky enough to act a lot and be on a lot of great directors' sets, and I had written, I had co-written, I had held the boom, I had edited, I had costumed, I had applied powder, and I felt like I was using that in a way to gather my 10,000 hours, or you know, whatever the Malcolm Gladwell's requirement is, and when I finished the script, I was like, you've always wanted to do this, you're not going to get any more information, you've just got to jump, you've got to go do it, and I loved doing it. It was a very wonderful experience of making the film, and I hope I continue to be able to act on with in projects that I love with directors that I admire, and
Hey, Greta. You are a wonderful actress as well. So just tagging on the previous question, as a writer and director on this, how was the temptation to, you know, take a part or to put yourself in, and your process of working with actors and an actor yourself?
Well, I never imagined myself in this film. I always, there wasn't a part for me, and also I really very much wanted to be on the other side of it. I wanted to be, it sounds absurd to say just a director, but I wanted to not, I wanted to not act in this. But I do feel that working as an actor for so many reasons is such good training for directing. One of which is that most directors only ever are on their own sets. They don't actually know how anyone else does it. And I've been on a lot of sets, and I've seen a lot of different ways of working and a lot of different ways of relating to actors and crew, and I've sort of seen what works and what doesn't work. And I took all these ideas that I've been gathering over the years, and they could be as little as things like having your crew wear name tags every day, which sounds small, but actors actually, if you switch out, you know, a camera operator, and they don't know who the new person is, and you know because you've talked to them, but they don't know. And it's like that, I stole that from Mike Mills on 20th Century Women. And so I feel like that was helpful. And then my greatest joy is working with actors and watching them bring life to these things that I've put on the page that are essentially dead until they bring their spirit and their artistry to it. So I adore them, and I think they know that, and I have a lot of empathy for what I'm asking of them because I've been there, and it's hard. It's hard, and I try to bring sensitivity to it.
Hi, thanks, Greta. I was wondering if you could speak to some of the autobiographical nature of the movie, and just if there was anything from the coming of age experience that you wanted to capture in this that maybe you felt like you hadn't seen before in other films.
And nothing in the movie literally happened in my life, but it has a core of truth that resonates with what I know. I think that I really wanted to make a movie that was a reflection on home and what does home mean and how does leaving home define what it is for you and your love for it. And I felt like, you know, it was a love letter to Sacramento, and I felt like what better way to make a love letter than through somebody who wants to get out and then realize that they loved it. And it felt like it was a movie that was framed around, you know, you follow this family and this world and this people, and in a way, it's secretly the mother's movie, as much as it is Lady Bird's movie, and that was the core relationship. And I felt like I wanted that catch where you realize, oh no, this is a love letter to the place, and it's also the mother's story. And I think that was the thing that I wanted, that kind of like reversal to happen, because I think that's the truth of no. Somebody's coming of age and somebody else is letting go. And I was just as interested in the letting go as I was of the young people's stories.
Yeah, really, the other day, Michael Shannon was here, another filmmaker, talking about growing up in Kentucky. He said, yeah, I really love Kentucky and I really don't love Kentucky. And so it's both at the same time. And
yeah.
Greta, your film is also about class, in a very interesting way that you don't see that often in American films. Can you talk a little bit about that, please?
Sure. Well, I think that, I think we're very, class is a very difficult thing in America. I think, one of my favorite filmmakers is Mike Lee, and he's British, and I think in the British class system, very clear of who's where. And I think in America, we all, it's something like 95%
5% of people describe themselves as being middle class, and that's people who fall in the end of the poverty spectrum and also at the very top, that we are very uncomfortable with class and how that works, but I think it's something that it's an invisible force that shapes a lot of people's lives, and I've always thought of it as kind of it's something that life is not fair, and resources are not divided fairly, either in talents or in economics. And I think it's something that I think one thing that I wanted to explore is, you know, Ladybird's always looking up at other people, at people she thinks have more and have it all together. And meanwhile, those people are looking up at other people. And she also doesn't see how much she has, because in a culture of more, 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 and I always need to get to the next level, that there's no way that you can appreciate what you have. And it's not explicitly stated, but I would guess that her best friend Julie looks up to her and thinks, well, she's got it. It's perfect. She's got a house, got two parents, she's okay. And I think that it's that disease that of always looking up and never being where you are, combined with the way these things are very real and they're very untalked about. It's something I wanted to explore and have a reality to.
Has your family seen the movie?
Yes. My parents came with me to Telluride Film Festival. I'd shown them the movie before, and then they were very kind, very wonderful, and they showed up and they supported me. And my mother just called me and said, "I just want to tell you I love you. I know you're very busy." And I said, "I am, but I love you." So they were very touched. A little earlier than I set the film. I did want it to be in a post 9/11 world at the beginning of when we were starting our invasion into Iraq and while the Afghanistan war was already going, because I felt like this huge thing happened and then we were ushered into a new age of global politics almost instantly. Everything was shifting, and we knew it was shifting, but it was also in a way invisible. I think that there's a sense sometimes in movies that it's like your personal life happens over here and politics happens over there, but that's not the way anybody lives. Everything goes together. You're living through the historical moment you're living through at the same time as you're dealing with your children or your work or your house or whatever is going on in your life. And I thought that it was this thing that was coming through and coming up, and it was like the beginning of, you know, not just this geopolitical moment, but also like the internet and cell phones and all of this stuff, which now defines everything. And a glib answer I've used and I have is that, like, to make a movie about teenagers now, you have to shoot cell phones, and so much of their life happens online, and I don't think it's very cinematic. And it felt like this, in a weird way, was kind of like the last generation you could make a film about without doing that.
Without showing shots of computers,
yeah,
and cell phones.
And like the made-up Facebook that's not Facebook.
Right.
Yeah, I hate, or like the Google that's like, giggle. And you're like, I know that's not real.
We have to wrap it up, but thanks everybody. Thanks for
Oh, thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're watching Hey You Guys!
Hey You Guys, huh?
Hey You Guys.
Is that from The Goonies?
It is indeed, yes.
Nice.
Hey